goal is to bring you your next favorite band.
Thanks for having us. This is a very cool show.
Yeah, so through many iterations, and it probably finally landed on the weirdest one by far.
Yeah, just a couple of feelings, and boom, you got a sound. Yeah.
I remember this one time, I had been writing some songs, and I went out. This I'm just going right in on this story. I went out, and so I was.
The story's longer than the song itself. We'll go ahead and play it.
And listen, it's going to be everybody's favorite band. Welcome to your next favorite band. That's both the show title and our promise to you. We here at Stereophilia Studio are tireless in our pursuit of finding incredible, genre-defiant artists who are either a hot, up-and-coming band or a group that has been delivering for years but have flown under the radar. Tonight, the pride of Stouffville, Ontario, from WXPN, the host of NPR's World Cafe, Raina Douris. Each month, we will bring you live streams, audio podcasts, and perhaps even a live concert where you can listen to the stories and hear the music of artists personally curated by us based on what we feel will be worthy of your time. Be sure to subscribe and tune in to each episode because the possibilities are endless and you never know who will be
your next favorite band.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show. I am your host, Phillip Reese.
Hello, and I am your co-host, David Moore.
And you are listening to
your next favorite band.
And your next favorite host.
Who finds next favorite bands for
Correct.
Many people.
Yeah, your next favorite other music discovery podcast show live stream host.
I mean, they've kind of got a little seniority on us. Just a little bit.
Listen, I'll come in second place. That's fine by me.
Yeah, look, we're podium. Like, cool. Like, I'm in.
Yeah, so tonight we have our interview with Raina Douris of World Cafe. Super pumped for that one. But before we get into that, did want to take a moment here to continue to give some pop to our upcoming event. Sunday, February 4th is when we're taking a moment to listen to the dissonance.
This sounds powerful. It should be.
It should be.
I mean, it should be. It's going to be a very interesting day of songs, a concert, if you will, and interviews with these artists who are going to basically, you know, share some stories.
Yeah. In the background here, I'm just going to play our trailer again. We'll talk over the top of it, but it'll hopefully allow us to, performers, you know, set the mood, if you will. We've got this great music by Mike Maines and the Branches, and the different stories from, you know, the prior interviews that we did where people have shared, you know, the struggle, the different mental health journeys that they were all on, and the moments that they've shared. And we asked them, would they come back and dive a little deeper into that? And everyone was inspired by the opportunity that everyone thought it was a good idea. Like, you know, you kind of hatch an idea like this and you worry because it is such a sensitive topic. It's such a private topic, a personal experience. And but we've seen it firsthand where when these different musicians share elements of stories like you're hearing in the background here or what you'll hear that day, people come up to them after the show and talk about how, you know, so grateful for them being brave enough to share that in a public setting in front of that many people, and that it meant something to that person where they were like maybe just a little bit more empowered to make it through the next day. And that it's just really kind of affected me.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to have some very interesting conversations. And it's going to be we're also going to get a chance to talk to some of them who have also, because of their relationship with their own mental health and the things that they've experienced, have also then worked within the mental health field. You know, and so that'll be interesting, too, to hear about that, too, from the other side of that part of the equation.
Yep. Two of the five are literally in the field of trying to help others.
Yeah, I mean, that's a significant number in this kind of setting.
Yes.
So in the way the day will be set up is going to be great. We're going to do brief interviews with each of the artists. They're going to get a chance to talk and, you know, and be vulnerable in this space. And then play a song. And then at the end of the day, we're going to do a songwriter's round.
Yep.
So it's going to be an opportunity for each of them. If you've never attended a songwriter's round, it's a really great way to see a concert where all right. the performers are on stage together. They each take a turn. So it's going to be a really great show. We're doing it in a great space.
Yep.
This is the first time we've been in the Ice House in Bethlehem for a one of these type of things. And Phil has, we're doing this one offline, if you will.
Correct.
We've
in person only.
Yeah, this is an in the room only kind of thing, and mostly because of the nature of the event. And on top of it, because of the fact that this one has a lot of performers, this will work better for trying to also then capture what that energy is like in the room. And it may not work well outside of that room.
Sure. Yeah, yeah. We'll share highlights of what we think carries, like what translates, but also, again, like we didn't want anybody to feel hindered by the fact that it was publicly being transmitted. So there may be elements that they'd be comfortable to share in the intimacy of the room that they might turn to us afterwards and say, I'd rather we don't include that, you know, mm-hmm. in the post highlights, which is going to be totally understandable. It's one of those things I do think it won't, something you won't want to miss. So if you can get to Bethlehem on Sunday, February the 4th, we're selling tickets. They're $10, but that is purely just to go towards the five different acts and or anything that is also left over would go towards the organizations that we're also highlighting that day. Backline, which is a wonderful organization that provides free mental health services and resources to the music industry. We have an interview with their executive director that's going to be coming out between now and the event. And then also NAMI, the National Alliance of Mental mm-hmm. Illness. And so two wonderful organizations. And so the only thing we're doing there is just trying to raise awareness and funds for them.
Yeah, it's going to be a great afternoon. Come listen to the music, learn something about mental health. If you're interested in about mental health, come listen to those stories and catch a few tunes.
Yeah, 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 yeah. And this coming Saturday, which would be the 20th of yes. January, we're going to be on our local news station, WFMZ. We had the chance to do that back in August just to kind of support our picks for Music Fest. And then now they're doing a piece about this event. So they're having us on to talk about Listen to the Dissonance. And, we're going to be able to bring on Kufnats and Christina Lise. As long as the snow doesn't get in the way, there's some snow that's predicted for Friday. And as long as that doesn't exceed expectations, they'll be there as well to talk about their organization, Higher Grounds Music, and then play some stuff live there as well. So tune in. I think it's 7:45 and 8:15 that we'll be on there. So, and we'll link to it as well. But please join us that day. It should be a very special experience. And now another special experience. We have our guest for this week. One interesting thing about Raina is, she does obviously a teaser post every week, Monday, that kind of tells everybody who's on the show that week.
Mm-hmm, right.
And she's been doing for the last, I think this is week 41, 42. So she's been doing 52 weeks. She was committed to doing a hat a week for a year. And so just had asked people, you know, either to recommend hats or submit hats or whatever. So part of how we, kind of met her, if you will, is we sent her our hat and she wore it. So this week on the World Cafe post, there she is wearing the Your Next Favorite Band hat. Some swag going on for our show. And that was in her post as she announced the week. And then we also spent time with her earlier this month. We pre-recorded it at a wonderful restaurant in Center City, Philly, called Louie Louie. So thank you to Louie Louie for letting us post up there. And thank you to Raina for meeting us there to do the interview. But David, why don't you read a little quick bio about Raina and then we'll get to it.
Raina Douris, an award-winning radio personality from Toronto, Ontario, is the host and writer of NPR's daily nationally syndicated music interview and discovery program, World Cafe. She has interviewed artists like Bruce Springsteen, Barbara Streisand, Questlove, and Brandi Carlile, and was a 2022 keynote lecturer on the topic of folk music and music discovery at Chautauqua Institution.
So here we are, Raina Douris.
Hi.
Thank you so much for joining me on a rainy day here at what better place to do a music interview than a place called Louie Louie?
I know. I had that song stuck in my head the whole way here. I was like singing it to myself. I'm like, wait, why is that stuck in my head? And I'm like, oh, right.
Because that's where I'm walking
to.
Yeah,
that's where I'm going.
Well, you're welcome for that.
Thank you so much.
At least it's not a terrible song. But anyway, thank you for doing the show. Award-winning, right?
Yes.
Radio personality. Of NPR's World Cafe.
Yes, that's it. Yeah. Thank you for having me. And I said this before we turned on the mics, but I'll apologize to your audience as well for my scratchy voice. I'm getting over a bad cold, but I'm here and it's really me, I swear.
And it's just a good sound for early in the year. Like, you know, it's sultry.
Yeah, that's sassy. What I like to say, it's husky.
Yeah. should also mention it is an NPR show, but it's recorded at WXPN in Philadelphia.
We're the community funded station at the University of Pennsylvania. Mm-hmm. So we're on the UPenn campus right now.
Right.
I like to say I work for an Ivy League university. Mm-hmm. even though I don't think even anyone at the university knows that I work there. So it's a public station that's attached to the university and we produce the show there. And then it goes out to, I think, 290 stations across the country.
That's fascinating.
It's really cool. Like, it airs in Guam. And I'm like,
You refer to that as like, oh, it's as far as Guam. And now you're actually in Guam.
It's so weird to think like, oh, my voice is in Guam, but I've never been there.
Well, we're actually even going to get to that from the evolution of your story. I thought I'd mention here too, like, you're doing this very cool thing where you're wearing a hat a week for 52 weeks.
Yeah, very cool is very generous. Thank you.
Well, listen, you gotta have a gimmick. But you do like a weekly post that kind of announces what's coming up that week.
Yeah.
And you just decided to do this thing. So I reached out about, there's a hat for your next favorite band. And I was like, she'll probably never respond. And then you did. And then I saw you at the Rat Boys show. And I was like, that's Raina Douris. So I went up and I was like, hi, not a weirdo, actually sent you a hat. And then we talked about maybe doing an interview, and here we are.
Yeah, I'm so happy that you did that. Yeah, I love that
you were there to see, I guess, a friend of yours in Free Range.
Oh, yeah. So
they were the openers.
Yeah, Eli Schmidt is from Chicago. Mm-hmm. He's like 21 years old. He's a really, I don't know how to describe it, but he's amazing. He's really kind of like the glue, one of those glue people in a scene there, in the DIY scene there, and he's kind of like up and coming in that scene, but also at the same time finding new ways to hold it together, and he has shows at his house, and he has a zine, and he has a radio show, and he's so cool, and
I really like the Chicago music scene.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of great things going on there.
Yeah, we went there for a sense of place trip, which is a thing that we do on World Cafe, where we visit different cities in America and around the world, and we kind of dive into this music scene there.
Sure.
We went to Chicago, and Chicago's so big. I mean, like, we were there for 5 days. It's not enough time
to
the whole music scene, but we try to get a good mix of things. And we went to Eli's apartment, and we hung out and watched a show at his apartment.
Oh, very cool.
With a band called Freako, who are great. Mm-hmm. It was cool. It was like all these, like, university kids, and they all, like, are sitting on the floor watching this band play live.
The opener is kind of what this show is very much about. Like, even Rat Boys needs more attention on them, but the band like Free Range or the opener, that's what I always love going to. So the band that I'm going to see, I never miss the opener because you just never know. Like, that's going to be some really, really cool stuff in there.
That's how you discover something that's actually new.
Yes.
Like, that no one knows about. Well, no one.
Yeah.
But you know.
Yeah. In fact, I have a string of people who I saw in the fall, like, basically since September. There's a bunch of them in the works that are all were the openers of people who I saw who either already had on the show or are going to have on the show. But then the opener was so good, we're scheduling them too.
Oh, that's awesome.
So there's a lot of cool stuff. That's a little preview for everybody. But be sure to stay tuned for excellent openers from 2023. I think so. Was a huge fan of World Cafe even before, you know, kind of getting to know your personality. And then since then, I just think you do this great job of keeping it genuine, disarming the guests, you know, and when I then had the pleasure of researching your history, like, I think there's these elements of your history, of your kind of your bio or your backstory your origin story that are highly admirable. So we're going to touch on these little moments here where I just think it's some very cool stuff, and I think we're going to get some good convo. One of the first ones is just simply here in Philly. Like, you've really embraced the city.
Oh, yeah.
We'll get to this in a quick second, but you're from Canada.
Yes.
And moved here basically in COVID times. I mean, like, you know, like, so
right before, about 4 months. Yeah. I had 4 months of, like, regular life in Philly and then COVID.
Yeah, but I mean, like, the city, the sports teams, the whole vibe here.
The pain of the sports teams. Which I've said, though, like, the Toronto sports teams prepared me.
I saw you.
Yeah, so I'm okay. I'm okay. I can handle having my heart broken over and over, and I'll just keep coming back.
Yeah, Maple Leafs for sure. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, the fact that you're out there and visible in the community and, like, you know, super rooting for teams and even talking about how much you love the city, that's, people here love that stuff. So, like, you don't have to be from Philly, but you have to love Philly, and it's not a city for everybody. So. I think it's very, very cool for you.
It's an easy city to love.
I agree.
Like, it's so, especially as if you're somebody who likes music or the arts, I mean.
Music, food, history.
Yeah,
you know,
all of
culture,
the best
here.
Dive bars.
Mm-hmm.
Of any place I've ever been.
Yep.
I feel like there's bars here where, like, if they were in Toronto, you'd be like, ooh, that's scary, we don't go in there. And here it's, like, the best bar
it
in
is.
Your neighborhood, and it's,
absolutely.
Like, amazing, and you go there all the
yes.
time. Yeah, and I think, like, the fact that it's still a relatively affordable place to live
sure.
means that the creative world is able to survive.
Mm-hmm.
People are able to make
that's
art
very true.
And make music.
That's very true.
And that's becoming increasingly difficult in cities around North America.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
mm-hmm.
around the world. But,
yeah.
You know, coming from Canada, that's a big problem. And it's amazing to see that alive here.
Yes.
So
and
vibrant.
I'm not checking my phone. My notes are on my phone. So
how for, rude.
Yes, right? It's like, I just got a text. I got to answer that. No, I'm kidding. Pride of Stouffville, Ontario?
Stouffville.
Okay.
But it is misleading. It does have two Fs.
Two Fs and you don't pronounce either of them.
I mean, if you're from this area, though, in the Philadelphia area, there's a lot of hard words.
Oh, my gosh.
Do you know how long it took me? And I still could be saying
yes.
it. Schuylkill. It
right.
took me
well, yeah, you've got
several
Native
attempts.
American. You've got some very Irish, like Celtic, Welshy type
you
stuff
like
going on.
You like the Pennsylvanian Dutch.
The Dutch
going
words.
On.
Yeah, you've got all sorts of, and then they none of them liked their vowels.
And fun fact, I believe Stouffville was founded by a person from Pennsylvania. Yes.
How about that?
If you want to go Google that yourself.
Yeah.
Just
well,
go
actually,
right
at. Don't add us if that's not right. It just is a nice story.
But yeah, so there you go. Small town just outside of Toronto. Kind of a bedroom community now. But when I was growing up, it was really small. My nursery school that was down the street when I was really little was literally on a farm. There were sheep. It was 5 minutes from my house. It was very, like, idyllic. And
it sounds like
and
a
now
Hallmark
it's a suburb.
Movie. Yeah. But yeah, so you grew up there in Canada. And I guess this was something I had read that I thought was kind of funny, is your voice is radio-friendly. But apparently it was not always the best for you growing up. And I'm guilty of this too, so we might get kicked out of here if we're not careful. Is I think you worded it as you have a loud voice that carries.
Oh, yes.
And so people know that about me too.
I love this. I don't know if anyone's ever asked me about that with that like note before. Thank you. See, I appreciate someone who's done their research.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, I would get in trouble all the time for being too loud. And I remember the one day that, like, it was in school that I realized that maybe it was useful, even though it came, maybe not in the way that I would have loved to hear it. I was in grade 7, and I went to an art school, and we did a Greek tragedy play, and I played the dad. Like, I played the dad
mm-hmm,
in a play.
Mm-hmm.
And my drama teacher was like, that was great, because you've got such a loud and deep voice that it's perfect for you to play the dad. Which, when you're, like, a 12-year-old girl...
Probably not the thing you
want to
hear.
What you want to hear.
Yeah.
But I was also like, hey, wait.
There was a part of you that
maybe
was like, tuck that away for a while.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that might be why they tucked us way over here.
Yeah,
because we're in the
corner.
Deep corner of this place. They might have done some their homework on us. So I think that the first element here is, so another part that came up for you, I guess it was in high school, was Markham District High School.
That's right.
So we have our NPR, or even like our public radio broadcasting, it's CBC in Canada.
Yes.
And the Iraq War was going on.
Yes.
And so they came to the schools to get students' perspective
on this. For some reason, they wanted to get Canadian high school students' perspective on the Iraq War.
Yes, which was clearly Nobel Prize winning stuff.
Sure.
But I guess teachers picked you because you were...
loud. And opinion.
And well, not good. That sounds negative. No, it's more like you were strong in who you were.
I've always thought opinionated is a positive.
I think so too. I just didn't want
opinion.
All right. So we'll use that. You had a strong opinion about things, and you were not afraid to speak. Mm. So they figured, let's put you on the radio.
Yeah. I love it.
Tell us more about that. Yeah,
so this audio does exist somewhere.
I actually searched for it. I was hoping to find it.
I can send you a link to at least somebody. Okay, I have a CD, and then somebody.
I would love to include that.
Took
or
out
just a link
all the
to
questions
it.
And just left my stuff. But it's there on my SoundCloud, but it might be hidden. I'll send it to you.
Oh, awesome.
It's very weird to listen to your voice when you're in high school sounding so confident about international affairs. To be fair, I was right about a lot of it, for the record.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was really great, and I mean, it was a lot of fun, and the host, Andy Berry, who is a CBC kind of legend, at the end, I was so excited, because my family was into CBC when I was growing up, and I said to him, like, I waited on a bench as he was, like, ready to walk out the door of the school, and I was like, Mr. Berry, I just wanted to say, like, thank you so much, and I want to do this one day, I want to be on. And I was like, I didn't really know what I meant, if I wanted to be on TV or I wanted to be on the radio. But I'm like, I want to be on. And he goes, thank me when you get your first Oscar. Which I was like, wow, thank you very much for that vote of confidence. maybe not an Oscar. Who knows?
Right.
Could happen.
Yeah.
But it was like the first time I'd done something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And immediately I was like, I love this.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know exactly if that was specifically... where I was going to end up on the radio, but it, like, something clicked on at that point. I really want to do this.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
And, yeah, so listen, so before you get to the actual radio stations, you do go to Ryerson?
Yes.
In Toronto?
It's now called Metropolitan University, I believe. They changed their name. But, yes, it was called Ryerson University.
And you studied radio and television?
Yeah.
So that's you taking those first steps towards not sure what you want to do, but the radio thing felt really cool, so let's put those shoes on and see how it feels to walk.
Yeah. The first year you do like a radio focus and then you move into it. Or I guess first semester you do a radio focus, second semester you do a TV focus. And I like being on screen.
Mm-hmm.
I love doing that stuff, mm-hmm. but everything around it in TV, especially on location, I was like, in Canada... Second semester is in the winter, and I was this is not for me.
No.
I cannot hold a camera like a boom pole out in the cold
for
hours. Not happening. Mm-hmm. But the radio side, I just loved it because you can do so much with so little.
Sure.
It's inexpensive to create.
Yep.
Radio is free to listen to if you have a radio.
Yep.
And it's so intimate. And you, like, the person on your TV screen, that you might recognize them if you saw them out in the world. You might see them every day and feel like you kind of know them. But the person on the radio, there's no barrier between you and them. They're in your ear.
Mm-hmm.
It's like this intimate thing. It can create images and a whole world if you let it. And I just think that's so cool. And I really enjoyed that aspect of it right away. Our first big project we had to do was you had to do a 10-minute radio station. So you had to do, like, a break, a PSA, an ad. You had to pick a song and do a sell into a song. And if you went too long, they would literally cut your mic. And
awesome.
It was, like, mine was
that's awesome.
Stoner Radio,
mm-hmm.
Rad FM. it was literally just baked weed. I don't know if I'm allowed to talk about this on your podcast.
Of course,
I guess
so.
So it's legal in Canada, okay? It was a stoner radio, and the PSA was about, like, a charity Pink Floyd Dark Side of Oz screening, and the ad was for my mom's brownie. Like, it was just so... But I loved doing it.
Collegiate.
It was just fun.
You were 18, 19
to play
years
with
old.
That kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And, like, what you can create with just audio is such a fun...
Yeah.
A fun thing, and it's so much harder to do that.
So then you graduate out of that, and you're starting to get into both CBC, and you mentioned it before, that Indie 88. I guess there was a moment you were just doing video blogs.
So right before that, I was at a station. I really got my real start doing, like, overnights and stuff at a station called 102.1 The Edge in Toronto. Big alternative rock station.
Got it.
But then I kind of started doing video blogs there, left that station, and then just did that for a while, which was really fun.
Sure.
Basically just had bands in my apartment, which, let me paint the picture for you. I'll set the scene. It was a basement apartment, a studio basement apartment. The walls were painted bright yellow and bright green by my friend who lived there just before me. So it looked like basically a takeout burrito place.
Perfect.
And it was, the ceilings were like, I don't know, maybe 6 feet. Like it was so, it was like a little cave. And I would have bands down there. And I was sponsored by a Toronto beer company called Steam Whistle. And they all, the only, I did not get paid. All I got was a case of beer whenever I had a band in. So, and I could just ask them, I'd be like, can you bring some beer over? Sometimes you bring 3 cases of beer. So my house was just full of beer. I had no food. All I had was beer.
It does sound Canadian.
It was very Canadian. and so, yeah, it would be like, I'd book bands, they would come over, and it was...
Do you have a picture of this, the yellow and the green and the beer can?
Oh, there? The videos are still online. God, you can find them. They are, they're on there. I'll send you some. But when I was doing that series, I was thinking about, like, okay, there's lots of people who interview bands about their music, but what is the thing I want as, like, a fan? I want to know what it's like to hang out backstage. I want to know what it's like to be friends with these people.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would get them to bring a thing that they were interested in, and we would do that, whatever it was.
Sure.
So maybe it was making vegan grilled cheese sandwiches, or the band Pup brought a board game that they had made up themselves, and we played that.
How awesome is that?
Yeah, like, and so it was really, it was really, really fun, and I loved doing that. It was also great because at that point I was friends with a lot of radio and TV people who would also work for beer, so it made it a lot easier to do than it maybe would be to do now. Mm-hmm. But it was, it was great. I mean, it was such a fun thing to do.
That is so cool. And you catch the attention of, and I love this part, there's another admirable one, both the CBC and Indie 88.
Yeah.
And from my understanding, obviously CBC is going to be a more, not illustrious, but like a more established position. And Indie 88 would be a little bit more, but you had more control, you had more,
yeah.
It would be like the underdog kind of winning.
So it's a little like... No, it's interesting because I ended up actually doing both, but the timeline is confusing. I worked very briefly at the CBC just on their online indie only Radio 3 station, which doesn't really exist anymore and was only online and on like satellite radio.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I did that for a little bit and then Indie 88 kind of like came calling while at the kind of middle of while I was doing
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah.
And you're right. I had like this moment after the indie job came up where I was like, okay, I could stay at the CBC, this very, like you said, established, sort of safer, I guess, path, or I could take this chance on a station that doesn't even exist in a position that is incredible, a dream job. Then I went for that.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, I was the music director and the afternoon drive host for the beginning of Indie 88.
Got it.
And it was so amazing.
So where is it? I forgot this one. I'm forgetting where this slots in. You went on the air without permission.
Oh, that was way... Okay, so that was how
I'm sorry I missed this, because okay. I think that's amazing.
So that was my very first radio. So when I was at 102.1 The Edge, I had...
There was you're interning there.
I was an intern.
And then you just go on the air.
So I was a digital intern. I wasn't even like an on-air programming intern. And we were working... I was working on this project that I was really into called Indie Online, and it was like, at the time, we were asking bands to like submit basically an EPK.
Yeah.
And every month we would choose a band of the month. And then we would play their song, and we would talk about that they could play in our storefront studio.
Sure.
And our afternoon drive host started letting me come on and talk about it, but then so did another host. So we had two hosts who were having me on every week or every couple weeks. I figured since they asked me on that it was fine.
Not her fault.
The program director did not know that this was happening. And he 1 week tuned in twice and I was on both times. And he was like, who is this?
Right.
I don't even know who this person is.
It's our digital intern.
So yeah. It's like, and then so the person who was kind of like the head of my department, like the go-between between our department and the program director, was like, hey Raina, I need to talk to you. Like, Ross heard you on the radio and he was like, what are you doing on air all the time? I was like, oh, I thought it was okay. I'm so sorry. I didn't know. She was like, well, he's like wondering why, but he also thought you sounded really good and was wondering if you'd like to train to do like overnights and swing announcing. Which was like the opposite of how I thought this conversation was going to go. And I was just like...
You thought you were going to get either fired or...
I just like kind of stared at her for a minute. And I was like, yeah, I do. I want to do that very much.
Yeah.
And so that was how I started doing on air work.
That is so funny.
Which was so lucky.
But yeah, again, like, that's not your fault. You would think the host would take some shrapnel for that one.
And also, yeah, exactly. It's like... But I guess maybe everyone wasn't communicating. I bet if those two hosts had talked to each other, probably wouldn't both have me on.
Mm-hmm.
It just worked out very well for me.
Yes. Absolutely. The universe was in your favor. So now you're at Indie 88 and you're establishing... This whole time, what's motivating you is the lack of attention on the indie artist.
Yeah.
And that's again, admirable. Like, it's like, you know, the music industry tries to do what it does, and it leaves those people out. It's doing it with streaming services, like the whole thing. But there's such people hardworking, doing such great work and writing such beautiful music, and it's just so hard to get a spotlight on it. So, but that's what you're trying to do for the most part.
Yeah, it was, you know, part of it was because I sort of started to fall in with a group of people who were really involved in that scene. And I remember going in the Edge one day, and I saw one of this band, like one of the group's bands, in like a bin of like our tons and tons of promo CDs. And I was like, I love these guys. And I asked somebody why they weren't being played. And he's like, oh, well, you want the honest answer? So their stuff very good. And I was like, that's not true. Like, we're playing a lot of really not very good
stuff.
You're not. And it made me really want to, like, I'm like, okay, I'm the one person in our group of friends who's like involved in this world. I wonder if there's ways I can push this forward. And like, especially when Indie 88 started, which I think was about 2013. It was a time where like that indie music scene was really like popping up. It was getting really big. And it was like, especially in Toronto too, it had that kind of like, Toronto's like the next big place. And so the fact that all we had was like a classic rock station and a big like commercial rock station felt like we were missing a big thing. So Indie 88 felt like it was filling a hole that was pretty significant. And we also had a qualification on our radio license because Canada has pretty strict rules about playing Canadian music. You have to legally play on Canadian radio in general about 35% Canadian content.
That's kind of cool.
That's qualified in a bunch of different ways. Sure. Well, who wrote it, who performed it, blah, blah, blah. But on top of that, at Indie 88, one of our licensing requirements was that 50% of that had to be emerging artists. So they had to be artists who had never had a song in the top 100, I think, in Canada. And so that made it so we had to play. We had to find these artists. We had to go out and like search for stuff that would work and champion them, which is great because even after the original people who maybe started the station are gone, they still have to do that forever, which really preserves that for Toronto, which is great. But it was such an exciting thing to be able to do. Like, the third song we ever played on Indie 88 was the song called Paper Girl by July Talk, which is a Canadian band who do great in Canada now. And they were people that I knew before the station launched. I was like, why aren't these people getting played anywhere? And we got to do that, and it was so cool. People like bands like Always, we played a ton. Really, really way back at the beginning. Like, there were a lot of bands like that we were able to sort of...
We went to college near Rochester, New York, and we did get like some residual Toronto Canadian.
Well, The Edge for sure has a huge... And they started playing a lot of that stuff after Indie.
Right. So some bands would come down through like Catherine Wheel. Like, aren't they Canadian?
Yeah.
So like, there's some bands that I just recall, that would come through either more Buffalo probably than Rochester, but still the local stations would be playing it, and you might make the trip to go see a band if you were super into them. So it was definitely like a 35% flavor.
Yeah, I mean, in that Canadian part music. Of the States, it is interesting. You do get like, The Edge has a gigantic signal. So like, for a long time, because in like the 90s and 80s, The Edge was called CFNY, and it was very influential as far as new music. And like, it did have that kind of, that reach. And so you see exactly what you're talking about.
Bands
that came down there.
Yeah, and then the venues would be booking them. Yeah. So, like, they'd just kind of be part of it.
And even
you are getting also, at this point, accolades. You're getting your awards. You become best local radio personality 2 years running.
In Toronto, I was, yes. Yeah. And it was very, not Philly yet. Come on, Philly, come on. what do I have to do? Yeah, I mean, that was amazing. I think, you know, when indie started, it was a really exciting thing for people who love music in Toronto. It was a new option. And getting a new radio station in general is so rare, you know, because there's a limited number of frequencies that you can be on.
That's true, yeah.
And so there was an excitement around it, mm-hmm. and we were doing things differently, and we were playing stuff that was different, and our approach was different. And I think that resonated with people. Not that I would love to take all the credit, but I think a lot of it was also the station. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting because now my show is syndicated.
Sure.
And the local element is a little trickier, mm-hmm. obviously. But I do think that that's one thing that radio does well is being local. And I love knowing, like when I do the fun drives here at XPN or when we have our events that are more local, I get to do the live stuff like the countdown that we did a while back.
Yes, yeah, we're going to have to get to that.
It's such a fun thing to be able to connect. Like, it's like probably, I mean, okay, you've got like local news, but local alt weeklies and publications are not the force they used to be. Radio is one of the only like truly beautifully local things that is so connected to the community. It's instilled that I just think, I don't know, I think that's really important.
Yeah. That's so true. It absolutely is true.
And that's my speech. Yeah, there we go. Local radio.
Yes. Yeah. And act local, think global. But what that does do, though, is it does pivot you in 2016 to then go back to CBC.
Yes.
And now you're doing the, I'm sure this was extremely workshopped, name of the morning show, Mornings.
Yes, Mornings on CBC Music.
But then also Music Backstage.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Backstage Pass, yes.
The TV side of it.
Yeah, so that would be, you know, live performances in a studio. And, you know, I'd host those. And then on air, I'd do the voiceover for it.
Mm-hmm.
And that would only happen like a few times, you know, a month we would record new ones. But the morning show was my first, you know, jump into doing a national syndicated show. Which was, it's a morning show that is live, but only for a small part of the country.
Right.
So
right.
You get up.
I can see that.
You got the East Coast. You're live on the East Coast, right. Except for Newfoundland, which is half an hour behind.
Right, half an hour. Yeah.
And then
I just went to see Come From Away, which they make fun of that in the show.
Yeah.
Like and we're only a half hour.
So you'd be like, it's 8 a.m., 8:30 in Newfoundland,
mm-hmm.
and like that was how you'd have to say it. It was very interesting because the country is huge.
Sure, it was massive.
Right? It's so huge.
Yep.
But like the population centers are very like concentrated.
Yeah, yeah.
And so you're trying to find stuff that is interesting to a population
more universally.
That is so gigantic.
Yeah.
So
and diverse.
Yeah, and diverse, yeah. Yeah. So like, and like, okay, so there's a big weather event that happens on the East Coast, mm-hmm. on the West Coast, they have no idea. It's like such a wild thing, but like, you know, it's the morning. Mm-hmm. At least you've got like that. You're like,
we're
getting away.
Need coffee.
So, yeah, that was cool. That was like, it was kind of mind boggling to think about how big the reach of the CBC is.
Sure.
And, you know, you were playing a really diverse collection of music.
Yeah.
The number of really interesting indigenous artists, mm-hmm. I got exposed to there.
Yeah, I could see that.
It was so amazing. Mm-hmm. And like, that also was what let me host the Polaris Music Prize, which is like the Canadian version of the Mercury Prize.
Yeah, I was just going to mention that. Yeah, yeah.
And
because you were hosting it.
Yeah,
yeah,
for several years. And just, I don't know, the way that Canada nurtures their music scene is, I think, really commendable.
Sure.
Sort of a necessity when you're beside one of the biggest culture, like, machines on earth.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I think, you know, people have, I think, you know, there's reasonable criticisms of it, but there's, I think overall, it's a really, really special thing.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, the working at the CBC is interesting. It's like,
yeah, yeah.
It's something that a lot of people grew up with. Everyone feels a sense of ownership,
mm-hmm.
because everyone pays for it.
Yeah.
Because it's taxpayer funded.
Yeah, yeah.
So people who don't love it,
they let you know.
They let you know. Like, that's the difference between public radio here and there. I mean, yeah, people still don't like things
right.
publicly funded here, but so much of it's community funded,
sure.
that people who don't like it They just don't fund it. Yeah, so.
Yeah. But yeah, like that's kind of what we were talking about before. This, like, you know, going from, you know, a high school classroom to a radio station to a larger thing, then all of Canada, now all into Guam, like we talked about before. It's like, next thing you know, you're
taking over the world.
That's right. You're going to be on Mars soon. you know, that's just very cool. And we talked about Polaris. So anything else come out of that, of the Polaris galas?
I mean, I think just a broader appreciation for the kind of music that comes out of the country. I think, like, when I'm working in radio, so much of the time you're thinking about playing music that is going to appeal to a really broad audience. Mm-hmm. The Polaris Prize is kind of patently not that all the time, right? It's a lot of it's really experimental. It's a prize that's, you know, given out in Toronto, but features a lot of Francophone artists from Quebec, a lot of Indigenous artists. You've got weird dance music or whatever it is, like stuff that you wouldn't hear on the radio. And I think that is really, you know, important to expose.
100%.
Because when those bands might not, even on the CBC, might not get a lot of play.
Right,
but they were getting exposure there. And I always said the shortlist is the most important part, not the winner, because it puts these names in front of people, maybe for the first time.
Yep. So. And you were a jury member, so you were voting as well as on the Juno?
Yeah, I was voting for all sorts of stuff. It was,
well, that's super cool. Yeah. That just kind of acknowledges you as being a part of the fabric of that element of that network and community.
Yeah, it was fun. I mean, I loved doing it.
So that is, this is basically now where it's 2019 and you're about to be announced as taking over as only the third ever host of World Cafe.
Yes.
That must be hard to leave all that behind.
It was.
Yeah, I'm sure it was.
It was. I mean, it was a really hard decision, not just because it's like, okay, you're moving to a new country and you don't know anybody and you have no idea what it's going to be like. But I did know that I was hosting a national music morning show, and I knew that I hope I don't torpedo any future job opportunities here, but I don't like getting up at 4 a.m. I really, really, really hate it. And that part I never got used to, and I was like, I don't know if I can do this forever. Mm-hmm. Well, I knew I couldn't do it forever.
Right.
And I knew I wanted to kind of branch out of the kind of show I was doing, which was, you know, just playing music, and which is great, but like I knew I wanted to do more stuff. I wanted to do interviews. I wanted to spread my wings and see what was possible. And
as evidenced by the first time you had a chance to do it, you were talking about what's going on backstage. Like, you want the behind-the-scenes story.
Yeah.
Not just
exactly
the music.
And to be honest, like, the American public radio world is a lot more varied and a lot more, there's just a lot more of it than in Canada. If you want to do public radio in Canada, you go to the CBC. If it doesn't work out for you there, good luck.
Right.
Yeah. Like, I don't know where you go. But here, you know, there are so many stations. There are so many places that it's valued in a different way. It's funded in a different way. And I just think it was something I wanted to explore.
True.
Plus, I hate the snow. And I hate being cold. And this is my opportunity to finally be warm all year round. But no, really, like, yeah, it was, there were a lot of things, but mostly it was like, I was just excited to see what it could be like.
And you took over for Talia, who was also Canadian.
Yes, an acquaintance of mine. And, you know, I have to give a shout out to her. She was the one who tipped me off that the job was available.
Yeah.
And she worked, our time at the CBC actually overlapped. We never directly worked together, but we were both there at the same time for a bit. And also, I believe, at Ryerson. So, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, there were some parallels. But yes, so that was, you know, Talia, I have to, again, another shout out. Like, she did the really hard work of transitioning from a host that had been hosting World Cafe for 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
She took over, which is really, really hard.
Yep.
She, like, got everyone used to that idea.
Sure.
And then I got to come in and a lot of the hard stuff was done.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I think that's really...
So maybe we can talk about that. Because I don't know if you're tapping on this at all, but it was something I was going to ask about just in general, because this is a little bit about a question around U.S. being different than Canada. And I was going to hedge in one area saying, I bet we're a little bit more caustic in that feedback. And I was wondering, was it hard? Music industry can already be pretty gender biased.
Yeah.
I imagine radio on the music industry is equally as such.
Sure.
And so was there issues there that she worked through to break boundaries that then, or just in general, the topic of gender bias in the music industry and radio, like you must have had to have pushed through and persevered some really difficult stuff.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I remember really early on my first job getting air checked. And an air check, in case you don't know, is when the program director will, or whoever the talent person is, will play breaks from your show in front of you, mm-hmm. and then you rip them apart. which sounds terrifying, and it is at first. Now I kind of like them, I don't mind.
Sure.
But you get used to
constructive
it.
Feedback, good.
But at the beginning, first of all, hearing your own voice, horrifying. Mm-hmm. Second, hearing your own voice and having your boss tell you all the things that you did wrong. Yeah, horrible. but I remember I was trying to be funny and silly and stuff on air, and my boss was like, you know, you don't need to try to be funny and smart and stuff. Like, you're like the overnight girl, like, and he played some examples of like girls with really husky voices. And he's like, you know why you're here. And I remember being like, oh. Mm. I guess I do know why I'm here now.
Right.
And like that, always, obviously, I remember that. Mm-hmm. That was bullshit.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I never believed that, and sure. It was fine. I mean, I got through that. But I mean, things have changed a lot. Like, I remember at the beginning when I started, I thought the only gigs for a woman in, especially rock radio, was midday host for some reason, mm-hmm. giggle girl on the morning show, and then like, you know, maybe an overnight swing announcer wherever they wanted to put you. Mm-hmm. Major day part, like, never.
Right.
That obviously is not the case
right.
now, which is great. And so, yeah, I mean, there's definitely things like that. I think sometimes people, especially when you're a younger woman, they don't trust you to be in charge of a show the same way. Mm-hmm. They don't...
which is shitty. Like, that's...
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's... you're not seen as someone who can lead the team, mm-hmm. Who knows what they're talking about.
Right.
And I think especially as you're kind of finding that your confidence in yourself and realizing that you know what you're talking about, what other people don't, it can kind of set you back. So you're mm-hmm. like, oh, maybe I'm wrong. Mm-hmm. Maybe I don't. And then it takes a little longer to get there. But yeah, I think you'd have to ask Talia, I guess, about what encounter was mm-hmm. when she first got here. For me, as far as like the audience is concerned, everyone's been quite nice. Okay. Unless my producers are hiding those emails, which is also very possible. And I guess.
But again,
thank you.
Constructive feedback, good.
Yeah.
Like misogynistic feedback, unnecessary. Like, don't nobody need to.
Yeah.
So like they might
like
be hiding
annoying,
them if they're irrelevant, which is the right thing to
you
do.
You definitely get like no, and this is a constant throughout my whole career. You get the annoying music nerd guy who, no matter what you say, is going to talk to you like you were born yesterday mm-hmm. and you don't know anything.
But I can only see that getting layered onto from the person who's like, oh, you don't know anything. Let me teach you something.
But the listen to the audience for World Cafe has been incredibly welcoming, incredibly nice, in a way that I was almost like shocked by because mm-hmm. like I knew what I was walking into.
Sure.
There's a big legacy here. There's a lot of like, I wanted to like... like do them proud
mm-hmm.
and carry it on, but do it my own way too. And like, I was so happy that I've been embraced warmly. It's meant a lot. So.
Yeah. And to your, like, you are now an example of what young females can say. They don't have a doubt in their mind that they could go and do what you're doing. So like that representation is huge mm-hmm. to kind of do those things. And again, I think back to what I was saying in the opening is like the genuine nature that you do it. You're not trying to hide who you are. You know, or not giggle, whatever. Like, it's just like, you're just being Raina and doing interviews, and it's awesome. So it's
thank you.
I just think that's really, really cool. Because it's one thing to push through, and it's a whole other one to also hold on to who you are.
It's a hard thing to do. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, you have a lot going through your mind when you're doing an interview mm-hmm. about, like, am I listening? Am I reacting like a normal person? Right. Am I like, you know, all those things? And then it's like, how much of myself is too much to put into this? When you're on public radio, there's also rules about things you can and can't say, or, you know, you want to make sure that you're being genuine, but also, you know, not being appealing to your audience.
Sure, sure, sure.
You know, you're not going to get your station taken off the air or whatever it is. Like, so thank you. That means a lot. Cause it's a thing that is, I think, one of the biggest challenges of this job is keeping your own personality mm-hmm. and still fulfilling all the duties that you have.
That's exactly right. No, I can totally understand that. But this is probably a good, like, kind of segue over here. As you mentioned before about WXPN does these very cool, like, lists.
Yeah.
In this particular year, to kind of parlay off of what we were just talking about, they decided to focus it on the greatest songs by women, which I thought was super awesome. And then, for those of you who don't know, we did a show about it just a couple weeks ago, about the list. Listeners are encouraged to put in their top 10.
Yeah.
And when they submit it in, all the listeners get compiled. And because of the station frequency being 88.5, they always do the 885 greatest of whatever the list they're compiling. Yeah. And so this year was, basically the rule was it fronted by women. So
yeah.
Like
yeah.
By women.
So sung by women.
Yeah. Yeah. And so all of, obviously, the personalities on WXPN got to submit their lists. And
yes.
They were out there. And I absolutely, this is, again, talk about being genuine. You had Cardi B on your list.
I did. It did not make the countdown.
which is a travesty.
I'm still a little...
And it wasn't just Cardi B. It was
WAP. It was WAP. Yeah.
Which is... Listen, if you
I was... If they had played that on the station... I mean, they performed it at the Grammys. That was my reasoning. I'm like, they could do it.
Yes,
it's a clean version
absolutely.
Out there.
Yeah. What was the other one that you had that was in a similar category?
Oh, 212 by Azalea
yeah,
Banks.
Yeah.
A song I listen to probably 3 times a week.
Yeah. And just fantastic. And again, like, that's what I mean. Is like, you would think that 20 years ago, someone in your position would be not only maybe hesitant to include those, even though you loved them, probably coached to take them out.
Well, they're very good about that, though. They'll
let you
do it.
That's what I mean.
Like,
it's, that's kind of talking about the growth and development of hopefully where we're headed. There's still a lot of work to do. But
yeah.
I mean, like, that's great because, again, somebody who listens to your show will be like, who are these songs? And it's going to expose them to something new and different. And I think that's what it's all about.
Yeah, totally. I was that countdown was interesting. It was the coolest thing about it was like just how unpredictable it was.
Yes.
I had absolutely no idea what was going to happen
mm-hmm.
in that countdown.
Yeah.
And I feel like we've done like greatest songs, greatest artists, greatest albums.
Yep.
And there's always kind of like the top guys
yeah.
who end up there.
Mm-hmm.
And this time it was so interesting to find out who it was going to be.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like I'm always sort of glued to my radio when these countdowns happen,
mm-hmm.
but I extra was at this time.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So hard to argue with the top 10. As it got, you know, towards even the top 50 or so, it was all great, great music. And hopefully what I even hope happened is people stopped focusing on the fact that it was a list about women and it became just a list about great music.
Yeah, I think that's what happened.
Yeah,
honestly.
You hope so. So it was early December, two other podcast hosts here in Philly, Dan Drago of 25 O'Clock Pod and Nate Runkel from Yo, That's My John, the three of us all got on and we shared our top 10s. We talked about that list. It was a super fun episode. So if you want to know more about the overall experience, go check out that episode. But I just thought that was a very, very cool thing that WXPN did. Couple of that just a like tidbit fun thing. So you do some voiceover like of like either cartoons or just podcasts and stuff.
They are like scripted podcasts.
Yeah. So Pretty Dim Wonder
yeah.
is one of them, which I got the note here. Interstellar Bartender Adventure Comedy.
That's right. I play the world's stupidest bartender named Raina, actually. Not
not typecast.
And it's a friend of mine, Charles Austin, who lives in Chicago. Spearheads this and does most of the writing for it, and I just love doing it. It's so much fun.
It was a fun listen.
Oh, you actually did listen
yeah,
to some.
Yeah, you
oh,
check it out.
So
and, episode one is another one that you do.
Yeah, so that's also his podcast with some other people, and they let me guest on it every now and then. Mostly, that podcast is improvised, but when they have scripted ones, I get to come on and play different characters. And we just did one. I guess it was back in. I want to say August,
mm-hmm.
Where we did Pixar's Sodas,
yeah.
which is about sentient anthropomorphic sodas
right.
in the style of like Toy Story mm-hmm. or Inside Out, who are alive.
Yep. And you played Pepsi?
I played Pepsi.
And again, I got the note here. When Pepsi is purchased at a Naperville Circle K, Coke and his friends go on an adventure of a lifetime.
That's right.
To track her down. And so yeah, check that one out.
Also features an original song called All the Bubbles in the World featuring Nate Rose of Fun.
Wow.
Yes.
That's super awesome.
My duet with Nate Rose of Fun, which we were not in person, but it was still really great.
And then another tidbit I found, you had, I guess this was back perhaps college years, adapted the Empire Records movie
oh my God.
To a stage production.
I can't believe you found that and brought that up.
I think we got to revive this and like do it at the Walnut or something.
I probably have it somewhere. The script is probably somewhere. When I was in grade 11, I guess 11th grade as you say here in America, I love drama. It was my favorite. I wanted to be an actor, basically, until, like, when I said on with that first radio appearance, most of me was thinking acting. And then it turned into radio. Anyway, when I was in grade 11, we were going to put on our big end-of-the-year play, and I'm like, I've been working on something. Which, I don't even know when I did. Like, it's weird to think of. I'm like, okay, I was going to school all day, and then I was coming home at night and adapting this movie to a play in the computer room. My parents must have been like, what is she doing?
What in the actual?
So I did it. I brought it in, and it gets so much dorkier because we're going to put it on. We're practicing. I'm playing Deb, who is the one who shaved her head if you've seen the movie. She's the main part of the cast, but it's a bit of a smaller part.
Right.
So I'm directing mm-hmm. also.
Of course.
Who
else was going to do it?
Exactly. And then the girl who played Corey, who's the main girl, played by Liv Tyler in the film, breaks her leg. And we're like, oh no. Only one person knows all of Corey's lines. So guess who played Corey? It was me. I took over. I played the main character. I directed and I adapted it. And it was a huge success. And at the end, when everyone had to do their evaluations, they all gave like the peer evaluations to my teacher. I ended up getting 100%
wow.
in my drama class. So I am a nerd.
That's fantastic. Yeah, I mean, that just, this is really, when you talked before about how much to insert of yourself, I'm just going to do it here. Actually, so I was a theater major in college, and I adapted Dead Poets Society for the stage. Oh. And I was just like, what a very cool fit. So that's why I had to bring it up. Yeah, it was really fun. We never actually did a full-blown production of it. We adapted it and did, like, kind of our own little staged reading for a small group.
Oh, that's so great.
And it was like, we ran into the difficulty of, like, wow, those scenes are going to be difficult on the stage. And then, you know, just get busy with finals or whatever.
Yeah.
But it was super fun, like, to get it to that point. Anyway, so, yeah, I just thought that was fun. And I think we need to bring that back. We need an Empire Records staged
production.
I'll
try to find that. And I'll remount it.
Yeah. And last bit of personal note, you recently married.
I am.
Yes, congratulations. Yes.
Thank you. Very exciting. Everyone says, I never thought I would get married. I never thought it was something I really cared about. Everyone says it's going to be like the best day ever. And they're right. It rocked. It was so fun.
Yes.
We had a great time.
So congrats on that. Anything to promote in the coming months? Anything for World Cafe? Anything for the spring? Anything for yourself?
Okay, let me think. World Cafe, we're about to release our Sense of Place Provo series. We went to Provo, Utah.
Nice.
You might think there's not a lot going on in Provo, Utah. It turns out there's a lot going on in Provo, Utah.
I can believe it.
And it's so interesting. Mm-hmm. It was fascinating. We met a woman who was in one of the first all-girl groups who played their own instruments, who got signed by a major label, who you've probably never heard of.
Sure.
But they're like, it's amazing. Her story is incredible.
Right.
She once dated Dennis Wilson. It's so interesting. We went to the only bar in Provo, the only place that is licensed where you can see a show in the whole city.
Oh, interesting.
Because it's Mormons, right?
Very much, yeah.
So we did that. There's tons. You'll have to tune in and listen to it. But it was so great.
That sounds awesome.
It was really cool. What else? I mean, I'm interviewing Slater Kinney tomorrow, but that won't be up for a while.
Right.
That'll be great.
That'll be super cool.
They're a terrific interview.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, there's always something.
Yeah.
There's always something. Follow me.
Yes. Actually, you're a terrific follow on, like, the rah-rah Raina, handle. like, again, very genuine to you, and it's like, it doesn't, like, sugarcoat this, oh, by the way, I'm on this nationally syndicated program.
I do worry sometimes.
No, that's what makes me stick with the follow-up. It was all this, like, you know, safe stuff. I'd be like, well, I'll just follow the World Cafe account.
Right.
This is like that, you know, well, you're getting the, you know, the Statler and Waldorf.
You
version.
Can follow us both, World Cafe and Raw Raw.
Yes,
Raina.
I would.
Then you can keep up with all the fun stuff that we're doing. There should be a new season of Pretty Dim Wonder coming out in the next while. I'm not sure.
I'm going to link to all this, too, in the show notes. And
right now, I think that's it.
Okay.
But I'm sure I'll think
if you think of something, you can sneak it in.
Okay.
So one last question. So I'm not going to ask it this way, because people ask me, like, what's your favorite interview? It's like, like all of them. Like, it depends on what you're looking for.
Right.
So, just any interesting story you typically tell, or something funny or interesting from an interview.
Okay. You know what? I was prepared for this question because I had a feeling you might ask.
Now I feel.
That's okay.
I'm predictable.
Crap. No, you're not. No, you're not. It's just, right. I understand.
Favorite
that
color.
People like to ask. People like to ask me this, and it's good. It's a good question. It always changes.
Yeah, but I never want to ask the favorite one because it's like I have like. I have 89 episodes. I have 89 favorite interviews.
Yeah.
Like, but if you're going to tell me what you're... If you want to laugh, it's this one. If you want to cry, it's this one. If it's...
I mean, the one that I was the most nervous for and most starstruck for and that I loved the most was probably Weird Al.
Awesome.
Because I love Weird Al. He's, I've probably been a fan of Weird Al longer than any other artist.
I would agree. There was definitely someone early on mine.
And he's somebody that, like, I listen to when I want to be cheered up. And I'm like, if this goes bad... Mm-hmm. It will never work for me again.
Yeah, no, you lose that.
And he was the best. He was so great. His manager wrote to me after saying how much he loved the interview. I was like, I loved it. It was great. It was one of my favorite interviews of last year. PJ Harvey, I was, again, very nervous. She was phenomenal.
Yeah, she's a powerhouse.
Just so fascinating. Mm-hmm. And really generous and open. And mm-hmm. I enjoyed that a lot. And Neil Young was a bucket list thing.
Mm-hmm,
and
sure.
Again, so nervous. Usually the ones I'm really, really nervous for and then they go well, I'm like, okay, that was my favorite.
Yeah,
so,
for sure.
You know, Neil Young was great. And there's a story I do tell about the Neil Young one that was so specific to a time because it could have only happened in like the pandemic era with Zoom. I had 90 minutes with him. And, which is a long time. And we were on Zoom. And partway through, maybe around like an hour and a bit, and he gets a phone call from his son, but it's on FaceTime. And he's like, sorry, 1 second. And he looks right at the camera, answers the phone. He's like, hey, buddy, what's up? And I can't hear his son. He's like, yeah, I'll be about like 10, 15 more minutes. Okay, yeah, I'll call you back. I love you, buddy. And he hangs up the phone. He's like, okay, anyway. And I was like, this
that
man
is so
it's Neil
cool.
Young staring into my eyes. And I'm like, I am experiencing what it's like to be Neil Young's son.
Right.
It's so intimate.
Yes.
It's so, like...
The humanizing of that, of this person that most people...
So crazy.
That
yeah.
is amazing.
Like, and it was, you know, I don't even remember if that... I don't think that made the final cut of the interview. We had...
That was something just for you.
It was just for me, and it was so cool. And I think that was like, you know, the pandemic was hard, but the Zoom stuff opened up a level of intimacy that was really interesting.
Oh, for sure.
And so that...
Raina Douris, WXPN, NPR, World Cafe. Thank you so much for coming on today and for joining me at Louie Louie on a very rainy day.
It's been such a pleasure.
Yeah, this was lovely.
Thank you
so much.
Now let's eat this cheese.
Yeah, let's have a cheese plate.
If you want money and you're comfy, if you want secrets in your tea, keep your paper heart away from me.
David.
Phillip. How was that cheese?
Cheese was good. Louie brought it. It was great service, great food, and a great atmosphere. I thought it was a lovely place to do an interview.
It looked great. It was a fantastic conversation. That obviously was very easy.
Yes.
She's a professional, and it comes across. But she was, as you said, the tables were turned. And so it was that was a nice conversation.
Yeah, thank you. It was, like you said, it was easy. It, you know, like, just kind of
had a narrative prepared, but I think she picked up on it so quickly because obviously that's what she played right into it and made it very, very easy. It just kind of flowed.
Yeah, there were points where it just felt like you just went Canada, and she just just went with it. Which
it was
good.
Like I was the password in the background.
The password is.
I just like the fact that because
this is now, in the industry,
this is this is going to be a Canadian trivia note. So CFNY that she was on, that she was referencing,
mm-hmm.
is the radio station that is referenced by Rush as the Spirit of Radio.
Wow.
There's a Canadian callback for you.
Well, I can't always count on you for stuff like that.
Well, when in doubt, Canadian power trios. Up next, my tribute to Triumph.
Triumph. Who had that on their bingo card
today?
Yeah,
exactly. Little Rick Everett for everybody.
So what did we learn? Raina Douris, host of NPR's World.
We learned that XPN apparently casts all of their new hosts from Canada.
Correct, yeah. It's a pipeline of sorts.
We learned that Raina is an extremely real person, which I know that sounds like an odd statement, but there's... the work that she does has a certain sense of celebrity to it. And mm-hmm. I don't necessarily mean that like world famous in the sense, but there's a protective layer that goes up that you have to deal with because of, like she said, she's nationally syndicated. She's in Guam, you know, like, I mean, it's,
who else can say that one?
Yeah, not us. Well, nope. Maybe we'll have to look at our downloads. Yeah, and,
we are still getting one download every episode in Germany though. We're keeping that streak
guten
alive.
Tag. And, it is, so that the fact that she still comes across as an extremely genuine and real, and like it looked like you two of you were just having a conversation. And so that is genuinely neat to see that from someone.
Sure. Yeah. Thought it was neat to learn about some of that elements of how licensing works in Canada and how some of those different stations kind of competed and supported each other.
I oddly knew about that, like, percentage has to be Canadian derived. And as she said, there's different rules for it. Like, well, if the composer is Canadian, but the performer is American or not Canadian for that matter, it like they have this crazy metric.
Yep.
And I'm sure it's in metric because they're in Canada, which, you know, because it just makes more sense.
but yeah. And then just I thought it was just so cool to see these. I love the story about how she snuck on the air.
Yeah.
And then they were like, that was bad, but you're good at it. So can we...
Shame on you for being naturally good at this.
Right. So like, that's amazing. Then she had the chance to pick the safe route or the one that involved shining a light on independent artists. She picked that one, you know, and just, I don't know. I just thought it was, she's as a person, as a human being, she's someone to kind of applaud and deserves the success she's having.
Plus, she's super into hats, and that'll get you an interview.
All right, Phil, let's say goodbye to everybody.
We hope you've enjoyed this episode of Your Next Favorite Band. We'd like to sincerely thank Raina Douris, host of NPR's World Cafe and from WXPN. And also each of those organizations, they've been hugely supportive of the promotions and the support as we headed up to this broadcast this evening. So we just want to appreciate her time. She's super busy and took that time out to spend with us and to share all of her great stories. We'll be tons of links in the show notes today because we've got all of her voiceover work. We've got all of the elements of her backstory that she's been a part of. We got to somehow find... You know, the secret things from her history, like the Empire Records conversion for the stage, and Rain's World, where she was in that basement apartment talking to an artist. So that stuff is out there. We're going to try and find it, especially that high school thing of the Iraq War. We got to find that one. Anyway, as always, our hope here is to bring you your next favorite band or music-related personality. If you tuned in today because you wanted to hear our conversation with Raina Douris, thank you so much. We hope you enjoyed it, and you might think about subscribing and following and becoming a subscriber so that we can bring you your next favorite band in future weeks. Also, over at nextfaveband.com is all of our prior interviews. Your next favorite band might already be out there, and you just got to go find it. Lots of great stuff coming up here, including Listen to the Dissonance. Hopefully you can join us for that day, and we hope to see you at a live show soon.